Because students, they are getting thoda sa restless. Students are getting restless. And moreover, sir, we have got audience online also. Online audience is also there, sir. Yes. National Science Day celebrations. We are delighted to have with us Professor Venugopal Achanta. Captain Sonpal Singh, Secretary General IETE on the dais, and distinguished Governing Council members and other members, ladies and gentlemen of the dais. We would like to sincerely thank our notable speaker as well as every member of our exclusive audience for honoring us with their presence on this momentous occasion. I request President IET, Professor A.K. Saini, to welcome our chief guest with a plant sapling and honor him with a token of our appreciation. Professor Venugopal Achanta. Thank you. I now request the chief guest and other dignitaries on the dais to light the ceremonial lamp. All that is needed to know that distinguished laureate and one of the India's best scientists. He received the 1930 Nobel Prize in Physics for his work in the field of light scattering. Using a spectrograph that he developed, he and his student K.S. Krishnan discovered that when light transverses a transparent material, the deflected light changes its wavelength and frequency. This phenomenon was subsequently termed as the Raman effect or Raman scattering, and he received this 1930 Nobel Prize in Physics for this discovery and was the first Asian to receive this Nobel Prize, a Nobel Prize in any branch of science. He was born in district Tiruchirappalli, Tamil Nadu on November 7, 1888 and completed his bachelor's and master's degrees from Presidency College, Madras. Shortly thereafter, he joined the financial services of Government of India in Kolkata. Later, he started doing experiments at the Indian Association for the Cultivation of Science, IACS. In 1917, Dr. Raman re resigned from his government service and took upon the post of Pallet Professorship in Physics offered by Shri Ashutosh Mukherjee, Vice Chancellor of the University of Calcutta. At the same time, he continued with his research at IACS. In 1924, he became the Fellow of the Royal Society and was also knighted in 1929 by British government. He presided over the 16th session of the Indian Science Congress in 1929. In addition to his Nobel Prize-winning work on the scattering of light, Dr. Raman worked on the acoustics of musical instruments. In 1934, he became the director of the then newly established Indian Institute of Science in Bangalore, and in 1947, was appointed as the first national professor by the Government of India and became the director of the Raman Research Institute, Bangalore. He was awarded Bharat Ratna in 1954, received the Lenin Peace Prize in 1957. The government has honored Raman by declaring 28 February every year as National Science Day to commemorate Raman's discovery in 1928. So to begin the proceedings, may I introduce Professor A.P. Thackeray, Chairman, Technical Programs Committee, who will be addressing us online and currently working as Professor, Department of Electronics and Telecommunications, Sipna College of Engineering Technology, Amravati. He has worked in the Defense Engineering College, Debrecen, Addis Ababa, East Africa as Head of the Communication Technology Department and Secretary Council. Professor Thackeray has over 89 national and international publications, two patents and nine copyrights to his credit. He held a number of executive positions prior to being elected to the IT Governing Council, including Chairman of IT Amravati Center. Presently, he is Vice President of IETE, Chairman Technical Programs Committee, and I now invite him to deliver his welcome address. Professor A.P. Thackeray.
हेलो, एम आई ऑडिबल?
Yes, sir, you are audible, sir.
या गुड इवनिंग लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन, गेस्ट स्पीकर्स फॉर टुडेज प्रोग्राम, प्रोफेसर वेणुगोपाल अचांता सर, डायरेक्टर सीएसआर नेशनल फिजिकल लेबोरेटरी, प्रोफेसर डॉक्टर ए के सैनी, प्रेसिडेंट आईटी न्यू दिल्ली, एस्टीम्ड गवर्निंग काउंसिल मेंबर्स present on the dais, off the dais, and distinguished attendees for today's program. On behalf of the IET, I extend a very warm welcome to all the dignitaries present here for today's program. I express few things over here. Every year, the National Science Day is celebrated on 28th of February. We at the IET, the Institution of Electronics and Telecommunication, has number of scientific programs that are including certain flagship programs also, which we conduct all across, all throughout the year. Every year, alternately, this specific program of the National Science Day celebration is either conducted by the either hosted by the IIT Bangalore Center or by our IIT headquarters. And today we are witnessing this program being conducted and hosted by the IIT New Delhi. This is the National Science Day is particularly celebrated in the to mark and honor the discovery of our very own Indian scientist, Sir C.V. Raman. He gave the remarkable Raman effect or the Raman scattering effect theory to the whole world. That was in the year 1928. He got the Nobel Prize in physics for this discovery in the year 1930. This day, as the Science Day, is not merely a day's celebration, but it is to raise the public awareness of importance of science and to bridge the gap between science and the societies. This surely facilitates to ensure the societal challenges that are being met through the scientific solutions, approaches, and the applications. We all are well aware of these applications to the humankind in the numerous fields, even including the healthcare. Today's theme is on electronics for quantum metrology. That way, our electronics and telecommunication has been one of the major facilitating engineering field to work with basic sciences for the benefit of human being. Quantum electronics as such, it contributes to the measurement of science, provides the standard institutions traceability, testing and validation, as well as the methods that support the benchmarking and the standardization activities. Metrology in that case is a science of measurement and its application, the system which ensures that measurement performed are meaningful and are in accordance with the international standards. The quantum electronics, which includes the infrared detectors, imaging sensors, photonic crystal, microcavity lasers, convergent devices, biosensors, etc. With that, I express my gratitude on behalf of the IIT to Professor Venu Gopal Achanta sir for honoring our invitation and being present for the today's program. I hope the deliberations will be enjoyed and there will be a takeaway from his speech as a main speaker today for this program. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your welcome and introductory address. Thank you so much. So, ladies and gentlemen, I take the opportunity to introduce IIT President Professor A.K.
So a very good evening to all of you. At the outset, let me thank Professor Venu Gopal Achanta, Director CSIR, National Physical Laboratory, which is one of the most prominent institutions in the field of measurements. It's really important to appreciate his presence today, because we actually requested him to be available for this lecture at a very short notice. We had the director of CERI, another institution of CSIR, to be delivering this note, but because of his urgent call from the chief minister's office, he had to go back. And because of this reason, we have to change the topic of today's deliberation on under this 28th CV, Dr. C.V. Raman Memorial Lecture. And I'm really grateful to him for being here at a very short notice. And I'm sure that the kind of knowledge sharing which is going to happen through him is going to be useful and meaningful to all of us and go a long way in making sure that India actually is emerging in the domain of measurements also in a big way, because we are finding new technologies which actually are coming up. So they all need this kind of a system to be in place. And NPL is one of the primary institutions which actually is working in this domain as such. So I, on behalf of the IIT, I welcome Professor Venu Gopal to be part. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. It gives me great pleasure to introduce our distinguished speaker, Professor Venu Gopal Achanta, before he delivers the 28th Sir C.V. Raman Memorial Lecture. Professor Venugopal Achanta assumed the role of director of the CSIR NPL in 2020. Professor Achanta has received his MSc degree from Central University of Hyderabad, his PhD in physics from TIFR in Mumbai, and his PhD in electronics from Tokyo University. He is on loan from Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, Mumbai, where he is a professor. His research interests are in the application of nanophotonics to single photon metrology, including single photon emitters and detectors and detection methodologies. He has over 150 journals publications. He is a fellow of Indian National Science Academy, honorary fellow of Metrology Society of India. He is elected to the International Committee for Weights and Measures. He is on the Executive Committee of Asia Pacific Metrology Program and Optical Society of India. He is member of IEEE Photonics Mumbai Chapter and member of the Asia Pacific Physics Conference's Condensed Matter Physics Section. Dr. Achanta, we are looking for your address.
Good evening, everyone, and thank you for giving me this opportunity. I was supposed to be here on 28, but my apologies because we have a large pool of students at NPL, about 300 students. So I thought like I should motivate and have some event at NPL itself. So that's the reason I couldn't accept your invitation to be there on 28th. So, but as God has written, like I'm supposed to be here and I'm here today. Right? So what I'll be talking about is electronics for quantum metrology. So most of you may not know about the, I'm not sure why this is, I'm trying to close the window. Videos ban kar diye wo side panel.
Achha.
शायद आप वहां से हो रही है ओके थैंक्स सो आई कमिंग फ्रॉम एनपीएल सो आई हैव टू इंट्रोड्यूस यू टू मेट्रोलॉजी एंड देन व्हाट क्वांटम मेट्रोलॉजी इज एंड वेयर इलेक्ट्रॉनिक्स विल बी यूजफुल फॉर द कम्युनिटी देयर आर लॉट्स ऑफ अपॉर्चुनिटीज सो द गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया हैज सेवरल missions which have been launched over the last few years, whether it is National Semiconductor Mission or 6G telecommunications or the most recent National Quantum Mission. So there are lots of opportunities at every level for the students, especially the future, because each and every mission has a deliverable target which has been envisaged and human resource training and development and opportunities for the trained manpower is one of the main focuses of each and every mission. So I'll show like so where we can have opportunities in terms of like quantum metrology. So if we go back to again, you'll not be able to see my screen. Okay, you can see my screen. So if you look at this, so we all know that these are the great pyramids of Egypt, and we all think about it and we say that like yes, so there is so like there should be some measurement, some tools to build these structures, and one such tool is a simple ruler, right? So if you look at this, so what is impressive about this is there are these fingers, and each finger from the right here So what you see is that it's divided into two units, then three units, four units. This is an Egyptian cubit. So this is there in a few of the museums around the world. So they had these precise measurement tools way back in when the pyramids were built thousands of years ago. Right. So if you look at the Indian context, we see pictures like this. We visit some of these historical sites. We see some caves like this. Not much impressive, just a hole cut in a rock. But if you see a structure like this, what we see is this is a double decker, there are two layers of it. And you see that there is some particular shape, which is the rectangular shapes and all that for the windows and the pillars and all these. Like, so there are some structures and geometry involved in it. Some measurement must have gone into this. Still not very impressive, excepting that these were from 3rd century BC. Or 1st century BC, Raniki Gufa from in Odisha. So this what makes it that, like, so about 2000 years ago, we had some bit of measurement tools or facilities with which we were making rock cut structures. If for those who are still not impressed, so we can look at, sorry, one more thing, I just need to. Right. Okay. So I hope this is better. So if you go to 7th century BC, so we see these Nalanda and Bihar. So these structures, what we can see is these are not just simple cubes or walls which are built, but these are shapes with changing curvature, and lot of architecture has gone into this. If you see at the edges, these are all bricks which are of very specific dimensions. Again, we had these technologies, we had this know-how of the measurement units way back about 2000 years ago. So these are apparent from historical sites. Again, like, so if you look at the left-hand side, so this is the division of time, starting with the second somewhere here. So we have gone way up to 10 power 22 seconds. We have these gradations which are possible within our Indian context, and down to 10 power minus 7 seconds or a fraction of a microsecond. So we could we have these units which are defined. So this is a conch shell which has gradations on it. So this is a scale which was used, like the Egyptian cubit. We had these graded conch shells which are used as scales. And more importantly, or most importantly, we also have these measures going from tons to measure grains to micrograms to measure diamonds or pearls. So we had these measurement units in our ancient society, going back up to 2000 years ago at least. This is also apparent from the book by Kautilya. So this is again around 1 BC, in which he has defined 16 different types of balances. So this is one such balance where the unknown weight and length into length will be equal to the into the mass times the distance of position of this arm here. Right? So this is one such weighing balance which was defined in that book. But over the years, over the centuries, it's not just in India, throughout the world, there is some anarchy. So people are measuring very informal ways, whether it is mutti or cubit, which is still common when somebody goes to buy flowers, for example. So there is some anarchy. And in the modern society, the earliest attempts to have a common measurement system started in 1215, where it's basically Magna Carta in 1215, like, so the clause 25 defines that the same standard should be there across England. So England, Scotland, and then later in the 18th century, the Peter the Great, the Russian Tsar, so he has adopted English system because it helps in trade, right? So that is a major step where, when we're talking about international trade, the common units are very essential. Right? So the meter convention, as we know it, and the international system of units, it all started in around 1800s or around 1780s, the French have initiated this system. So the first, very first definition was the meter, where it is defined as the distance 10 power minus times the length, which we, when we measure from the North Pole to the equator. So this distance is expected to be 10,000 kilometer. So divided by 10 power 7 will make it 1 meter. But the problem with this definition is that, like, who is going to measure accurately from the North Pole to the equator and then divide it by 10 power 7 and then make that scale to say that, oh, this is the meter. But then there was a beginning. Similarly, kilogram was defined as a weight of 1 cubic decimeter of water. And this progressed. Around 1875, 17 nations came to Paris to sign the first meter convention. Then from 1875 to 1971, the seven SI units, the International System of Units, meter, second, right? You have mole, you have candela, all these things start, were added. And then we have the seven SI units, which we use currently. In India, the system started in 1946 with the setup of Indian Standards Institution. It is now called the Bureau of Indian Standards, which is the standards body, which makes the, which lets us any standard which we need on paper. So if you want any standard for some particular parameter, so the BIS through its standards committees, they formulate these standards and then file them. So now what does NPL do? NPL as the National Standards Laboratory or the National Metrology Institute, we set up those standards and make them available for the country, right? So, so this was set up in 1947. We completed 77 years. So 4th January 1947, it was set up in Delhi. So we had this law of weights and measures, and then eventually, like, we became part of this Asia Pacific Metrology Program. We are the founder members of APMB. This was in 1984. Now, coming to the current system of measurements, we have mostly, if you talk about physico-mechanical parameters, like, for example, kilogram or a meter, we still use these prototype-based measurement systems. So a kilogram, if you go to a shopkeeper, he uses a kilo or half kilo or whatever, 100 grams, a weighing stone. That stone is actually a copy of the one which is shown here. This is a national prototype for kilogram, NPK57. We got this from BIPM, which is the international body, which is in France, which regulates all things related to the SI units. So this is the kilogram copy, which we have at NPL. We make copies of this kilogram and then make the measuring weights, which we use it in shopkeeper level. Similarly, the meter rod, even the foot putty, whatever, like the rulers which we use. So they're all copies made from this international prototype for meter, which is again at NPL. So if you look at the quality infrastructure, as I mentioned, we have this Bureau of Indian Standards, which is a national standards body. And then we have this NPL, which is a National Metrology Institute. And to go down to the shopkeeper level, what we have is in between the NABL, NABH, NABCB. These are the accreditation bodies, which are part of this Quality Council of India. And we have this Legal Metrology Department under the Ministry of Consumer Affairs, which form, these four form basically the four pillars of the quality infrastructure within the country. So we set up the standards, we help formulate the standards, we set those things in at NPL, and then we make sure that they're available to accredited laboratories, for example, NABL or NABH accredited laboratories, and legal metrology, and down to the shopkeeper level. So we played two roles. As the Metrology Institute, one is to couple to the international community. So when we are saying that we are measuring 1 meter, why should it be accepted at the international level? So if, when we're exporting something, why should they accept that, like, oh, you're sent 1 ton of something? So that happens because whatever standards we have at NPL, we do an intercomparison and plot something like this, which is shown on the right-hand side top. So each point here corresponds to one country. So they measure the parameter and then say that this is our uncertainty. Then once we measure it at NPL, we say that the community, international community, they come and then they basically check how we are measuring, what is the methodology we are using for analyzing the data, how we are calculating the uncertainty. All these things are go through rigorous checks. And finally, the values are plotted like this. So each country is plotted. So based on this, we know whether we have a capability which is at par with the rest of the world or not. So this is another example of this. So it can be measurement of force, or it can be measurement of carbon dioxide in air, right? So we do all these checks for different parameters which we have. So once we have this, so this is known as the measurement capability, the calibration or measurement capability for the country. And we maintain that so that it is available to the rest of the community through these regional reference standard laboratories of legal metrology, or NABL accredited laboratories down to the shopkeeper level. And whatever facility which we set up at NPL is accepted because we have signed this mutual recognition agreement, which is honored by about 140 countries, which are all members of the BIPM or CIPM. Right? So at NPL, we have 6 divisions. So if you look at this, like the first one is the physico-mechanical metrology, like kilogram, length, force, temperature, all these things are in this physico-mechanical metrology division. Then we have electrical and electronics metrology, where we have voltage, current, resistance, capacitance, and all the derived units are there. So we can measure 1 volt with 60 nanovolt precision. The best in the world is 40 nanovolt with the Korean Metrology Institute. Quantum Hall resistance, so the resistance, 1 ohm, for example, or any resistance, we can measure to 8 parts per billion accuracy. Then we have this environment and biomedical metrology, where we have, for example, most of us heard about, I think it will go away for some time. So we heard about this Maitri station in Antarctica. One of our scientists from NPL was the lead scientist in setting up the first station at Antarctica. And in environmental sciences, we do quite a bit of instrumentation as well as facilities to, for example, PM 2.5 samplers or PM10 samplers. So how do we characterize them? How do we certify them? So we are starting a certification scheme in the next couple of weeks. And we also work on this biomedical metrology. For the first time, we have these biomedical metrology facilities where we have the calibration testing facilities for defibrillator, which is used for when somebody gets a heart attack, like the shocks. So that's a defibrillator we have for the infusion pumps so that we can precise injection can be done, given. And in the materials and device metrology, we have this waste to wealth. So one of the areas, recent areas, which we are working on is recycling of solar waste. So most of the electronic waste nowadays focuses on extracting precious metals, whether it's gold or platinum or something. But what we are not considering so far is the government has ambitious plans of solar cell capacities. We are setting up about 50 gigawatt capacity per year. So or 10, 15, 20 years down the line, so there's tons of silicon waste is going to come up. So what are we going to do about it? So what we have done is we have demonstrated that we can get 4-9 purity silicon by recycling the existing solar waste from the panel, solar panels. So this technology, like, so we make it, improve it so that we can transfer it to the industry so that it can be taken up. So we do a lot of carbon waste, for example, bio waste. So we convert into carbon nanotubes used for supercapacitors, batteries. So we have a lot of opportunities there. Then we have this plastic waste to wealth. So this again, we do it. So the carbon composites are also used for in the nuclear reactors. These are the fuel tubes for compact high temperature nuclear reactors. If you see the Agni missile of Indian Defense Forces, the cone is a carbon composite which was developed at NPL and transferred to DRDO. So we also have this Bharati Nirdeshak Dravya. So most of the time what happens is we have a lot of equipment, heavy equipment, which we cannot carry to a nearest lab to calibrate them. So what do we do? whether it is a XRD machine or a spectrometer or a multimeter. So what we do is we make these Bharati Nirdeshak Dravya. These are the certified reference materials. So you can use these materials and then characterize or test your equipment, calibrate your equipment against this. We have these BNDs right now for gold, silver, rice, water, chemicals, cement. These are many of them are being exported currently. Indian Standard Time, for all the Marvel fans here, like, so we are the timekeepers of India. So we manage the Indian Standard Time. So our time with which we provide, is one of the lowest uncertainties between 2 to 3 nanoseconds compared to the universal time. So our Indian time is very accurately available down to a few nanoseconds. So we make this available to all the network times which you get, ISRO or defense labs. So we provide them the time for this. Okay. So we cater to a wide variety of industries, starting from automobile to textiles and testing laboratories. So we cater to about 4,000 industries across India and the SAARC nations. So just to come to the introduction of quantum metrology, I mentioned that we use this prototype currently to measure the kilogram or the weight is to be made. But one thing which interesting which people found from all the countries is that there is one international prototype which is maintained at BIPM in Sèvres in France. So 6 copies of it were made, and then each country got 1 copy made. So every few years, 3 to 5 years, we have to take it back to Sèvres, and then at BIPM headquarters, like, so we have to test it whether how much is the real weight of this. What people found is that over the years, every time the weight of the prototype is measured against the international prototype, there is a fluctuation in the weight. It is of the order of like plus minus 50 micrograms over 1 kilogram. Okay. But if you want precise measurement, even that is not acceptable. So people tried to understand why this is happening. So, but there is no real logical reason, like, so which people could come up to explain why this uncertainty is happening periodically or over time period. So even our national prototype, it showed this variation over the years. So there is any prototype base. If you take a scale, the gradation has certain width. If it is of the order of like microns, that is going to add up to your uncertainty. When you're measuring a millimeter using your ruler, so that gradations in the width of the gradations is also going to contribute an error to the measurement of your length. Right? So these are all, when you're talking about high precision measurements, right? So these all will matter a lot. 50 grams is not much for a 1 kilogram, but we are talking about buying diamonds. So you all always get cheated even with that 50 microgram of fluctuation. So in 2019, the world over, people have accepted the new definitions for metrology. These are not dependent on prototypes, but these are all linked to the universal constants. So universal constants are very precise accepted values as of now. Right. These are all the values of the universal constants which are accepted at the present time. Right. These may change later on, but the idea is that there is a fixed value which we want to measure. So, for example, if we want to measure a kilogram, we don't have a prototype, but what we do is we measure the Planck constant with as high precision as possible. Then the Planck constant is related to the mass. Similarly, the meter is related to the speed of light in vacuum. And second is related to the hyperfine transitions or the Rydberg levels in different atoms. So like that, every SI unit is defined in terms of a universal constant. So this is the current status. So we are working on many of these currently. Second, we have revived our cesium fountain. So kilogram we are working on, Kelvin we are working on, ampere is working on, meter, laser interferometry base we already have. And mole, we are working on candela we have in the country. Okay. Now, just to explain to you how the Kibble balance works, how these non-prototype based or a universal constant based a mass or a weighing scale work. putting it very simply, what we'll be doing is comparing the gravitational force due to weight or mass to the electrical force or electrical power. Basically, the mechanical and the electrical powers are being compared. So if you put a mass, unknown mass, on one side of a pan of the pan in a weighing balance, so it's going to go down. Now, if you put a coil on the other side and apply some current through it, so the electrical force is going to push the coil down if it is put in a big permanent magnet. Now, by measuring very accurately how much current we are passing so that these two pans are balanced, then we know the electrical force and we know the gravitational force. So we can get accurately the weight, unknown weight in this case. But the problem, one problem with this is the length of the coil and the magnetic field induced, these are parameters which will always be a problem for us. So to remove these two parameters, what we do is we do a second measurement without the unknown mass in the pan. So we apply, we move this coil up and down with a constant velocity. When we move this with constant velocity, there is an induced field which is generated in the coil, in the circuit outside. So we measure this induced voltage, which will have this B and L values, and the velocity, which we know at what velocity we are moving this coil. Now by taking the ratio, we can actually cancel out the B L values. And eventually what we get is Planck constant in terms of this mass, and the rest of them are all universal constants. So for this, we need to have current standard, voltage standard, resistance standard, optical standards, because we need to measure precisely how much is the movement of the coil. So this is a complex beast, but it is possible to do this. People have demonstrated in at least three countries. So this is our first prototype. This is for a 10 gram mass. Sorry, I think it got disconnected from the Zoom. Yeah. Okay. So this is the 10 gram prototype which we built, and currently we're working on the 100 gram. Eventually, we have to go to 1 kilogram cable balance. Right. Just to show the complexity of this, the machine which is built, for example, in NIST in USA. So they have a machine which looks like this. Okay. Just to show the scale. So this is one at BIBM in France. So where you can look at the height of this. This is a 1 kilogram balance, cable balance. So you have opportunities for development of electronics, structure design, robotics. You name the field, like we need it to build this cable balance. And we are very open to students and enthusiastic engineers from all fields to help us out in building this for the country. Okay. So this is the... our picture of our cesium fountain. So we were the fifth country in the world to make our own atomic clock way back in 2013. So we contribute to the calculation of universal time at the time till 2015. Right. So if you look at it, so this is all the optics. This is the what they call the physics package, where the atoms are trapped and then they're launched up into the space. And then they're probed with RF field, right? So you need RF electronics for this. You need the pulse. modernize this with FPGA-based electronics to use them for optical clocks, which is the next generation clocks, which use ions rather than the atoms in this case, because we get 10 power minus 18 second uncertainty with the new generation of optical clocks. So this is how one of these optical clocks look like. This is just a part of it. The chamber is shown here. So we are. Generates multiple beams so that we can trap atoms on top of the surface, so that instead of having these complex vacuum chambers and systems, we can have just a simple chip on which, like, we on top of which we can trap single atoms or ions, so that we can have on-chip atomic clocks in future. So this is for the quantum technologies. Single photon detectors, whether it is quantum communication or quantum computing, single photon detectors are very, very essential. There are two markedly different technologies which are used. One is based on superconducting nanowire-based single photon detectors. So this meander structure, which you see here, so this is a superconducting nanowire of about a few tens of nanometer in width, and this is about millimeter kind of dimensions. So this whole thing is under low temperatures. We are talking about a few Kelvin of temperature. So we need electronics. For example, the pulse signal which is coming out of it. When a single photon falls on this structure, it creates a local heating, and then that leads to change in the resistance, and that leads a voltage pulse. So that voltage pulse has to be amplified at the low temperature itself before we can bring the signal out of the cryostat. So we need low temperature preamplifier or low temperature amplifier and low temperature electronics so that we can have efficient single photon detectors for future. The other technology is the silicon photomultipliers. These are basically arrays of silicon avalanche photodiodes. So the idea here is that avalanche photodiode, when you operate it in the giga mode, so just bias it at the knee, and even a single photon falling on it will generate or trigger the avalanche, so that you have a output pulse which comes out whenever there is a single photon falls on it. So this is very standard technology. This doesn't require very low temperatures, but still to reduce the thermal noise. These are all under thermoelectric cooled devices. So you can also have the silicon photomultiplier. We are talking about Sashakt Bharat. So for defense applications, for example, one of the important thing is we want to see something beyond an obstacle, right? So how do we do that? So one of the ways is we can look at the scattered photons. We can see each other clearly because a reflected light from you is reaching me. But we can also see something which is happening behind, because there are photons which may be coming from behind the curtain, and few photons must be coming. So if we can image, if we can detect those single photons which are scattered, single photons which are coming, we can, we may as well image objects or what is happening behind obstacles. So for these, like, we need these single photon detectors, array imaging detectors. So for this, like, we can have this array of APDs, and if we can read out each of these pixels, so we can use that as a single photon imaging source. This can have biological applications. We can image biological as well, and it will have multiple applications, right? Not just quantum technologies, like quantum information processing. We can also use it for defense and biological applications. So just to show, like, so I talked about this part where we have these seven SI units, which are listed at the top. So from that, like, so we have already have these facilities at NPL, and we are also working on this next generation of these quantum metrology standards. We are setting these things up. This will help us in higher precision measurements. And eventually, when you're talking about quantum computing or quantum communication, you want to have qubits, you want to have single photons, you want to have non-classical photons, not just single photons, you want to have entangled photons. Who is going to measure them? Who is going to test them? And how are they going to test them? So for this, eventually, whatever detector, whatever sensor, we all know that eventually it'll all boil down to how much voltage it is giving, how much change in resistance it is showing, how much current is coming out, right? So we all come back to transmitted over short distance and then decoded. The quantum nature comes in because we use the transitions corresponding to these very fine, hyperfine levels or the Rydberg levels of these atomic transitions in rubidium. And unless we know which rubidium atomic levels we used, so it will not be possible to decode these signals. So this quantum sensing has also security applications. So for all these, like, electronics is the backbone. And specifically, what I mentioned is low temperature electronics, like amplifiers, silicon avalanche photodiodes, photomultipliers, pulse sequence generators for optical clocks, FPGA. Which you're talking about, can we combine photonic ideas and electronic principles together and make much more efficient devices for the future? So this is something which is just about coming up, and this is the high time that we start thinking, not just in one of the branches. Now we need to combine them together and come up with much more efficient and challenging devices for the future. Thank you very much. Have any questions?
Yeah, please sit down, then we'll.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Professor, for that insightful talk. I have a couple of questions based on your talk. Of course, the answer would be important. You mentioned that since cell phone will be used as well, then we have a proposal to recycle this. Similarly, lithium will be great for the next. So that will be a problem in the future. I think you have a question to ask before. Then this question of
We are in talks with ISRO so that we can build the optical clock for them also, so that they'll have the optical clock in house. So we have quantum metrology is something which we have taken up as an in-house project, and we are working on all these seven things. And chip making, so metrology is very, very important. So the semiconductor industry, one of the major issues is the dimensional metrology. So they have their own very advanced metrology facilities within the semiconductor industry. So now what we are trying to look at is if we can talk to them, if we can get together with them and set these things standards, which will be useful even for other industries, because they can go to sub-nanometer questions.
Thank you very much. And just for the, for information of the youngsters behind, there is metrology and there is meteorology. I hope you understand the difference. Down this road, only on Lodi Road, we have the headquarters of the IMD.
Also.
Meteorology looks at forecasting the weather.
Yes.
So the difference is only one E and one O. Between metrology and meteorology. And that EO actually is, if you want to remember, Earth observation. Because of Earth observation, you get weather forecasting. So that's the difference between metrology and meteorology. Thank you once again.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
I'm sure today's illuminating talk will give us better understanding of important issues concerned with nations, seedless pursuit of electronics research and development, and developing measurement standards for futuristic technologies, and how NPL is aiming towards high caliber research and development in innovative technologies in engineering, electronics, and related sectors that have a big strategic and social impact. So it's encouraging to see visionary leaders like you, sir, to guiding us towards success. Thank you so much. So I now request our past president, Lieutenant General Dr. K.S. Chandele, to honor and felicitate our distinguished guest.
Any online questions you have? Maybe you can ask.
Any other questions?
Online.
Okay, online viewers, if you have any kind of question for our chief guest, you may ask. The online viewers. A big round of applause for Professor Vinay Gopal Chandra, please. Thank you, sir. I now invite Secretary General IT for a formal vote of thanks.
Respected Chief Guest, Professor Venugopal Achanta, Director CSR NPL, President IIT Professor Dr. K. Sani, Past President Lieutenant General A. K. Chandele, Online Chairman TPC Dr. A. P. Thakre, Governing Council Members, Brigadier V. K. Pandey, Mentors, Executive Committee Members of IIT Delhi and Noida Center, Corporate Members, students from IITM and Bharatiya Vidyapeeth, Deemed University, other dignitaries, online participants, ladies and gentlemen. It is my proud privilege to propose a vote of thanks to all the dignitaries who have joined us in commemorating 28th Sir C.V. Raman Memorial Lecture as part of National Science Day program celebration. I would like to express heartfelt thanks to our distinguished chief guest and keynote speaker, Professor Venugopal Achanta, to accept our invitation to deliver this lecture. Special thanks for accepting our request on such a short notice. I would once again like to thank Professor Venugopal for sparing his valuable time out of his hectic schedule and giving us an insight and his knowledge sharing on measurements, various quality standards, atomic clock, and electronics associated with multiple advanced systems. Thanks to Professor Dr. A.K. Saini, President IIT, for guidance and motivation in arranging this talk. Special thanks to the past President, General Chandele, sir, and those available online. We get a Vicky Pandey, sir, your mental notes. Governing Council members, Sri Gurmukh Singh, Dr. Siv Kumar, and those members available online. Thanks to Executive Committee members of Delhi and Noida Center. Again, thanks to faculty members, faculty from IITM and the students from the IITM and the Bharatiya Vidyapeeth University, those who are present here. As well as, again, thanks to all of those participants who are available online. Lastly, I take this opportunity to thank all the staff members of IIT headquarters for making all the administrative arrangements for the successful conduct of this evening. Thank you very much. Now I'll request everyone to rise for national anthem. I deserve all of them.
Thank you so much. We are requesting you please join us outside for tea. Thank you.